Welcome to our lecture on anxiety in teens, presented by the CU's Helen and Arthur E. Johnson Depression Center. To worry or not to worry, wouldn't it be nice to have a choice? We have a very distinguished speaker here tonight. Dr. Marianne Wamboldt is the Wolbracht Family Professor of Stress and Anxiety Disorders in the Department of Psychiatry at the University of Colorado. She's a board-certified child and adolescent psychiatrist with over 30 years of clinical, teaching, and research experience. She spent 10 years as the chair of psychiatry at Children's Hospital Colorado and vice chair for child psychiatry at the University of Colorado. Her interests have focused on the role of family relationships in medical and psychological outcomes for children and teens, behavioral genetics as a tool to understanding the intersection of medical and psychiatric problems, and clinical interventions for children and adolescents with anxiety, mood, and pain disorders. As a registered yoga teacher, she's very interested in yoga and mindfulness for treatment of anxiety and depression. Dr. Wamboldt has been a member of the psychiatry faculty since 1990. She leads the family team unit, which treats children, teens, and their families at CU's Johnson Depression Center, one of the national networks of depression centers. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Marianne Wamboldt.
Thank you, Carol. Well, thank you for taking time out of your busy weeks to come to a lecture. I really applaud you all for caring about this and for caring about your kids and your families to come here. Some of you may have heard a talk I gave on mindfulness at the Denver School for Performing Arts. Can I just see how many people were there? Okay, not very many. I'm not going to talk a lot about mindfulness today because the topic's anxiety, but they go very closely in hand. So let me just give you that caveat and we will start. Okay, so today I was going to talk a little bit about what is anxiety, when is it normal anxiety and helpful, and when does it become not helpful and therefore a disorder, and then what kinds of things can you do for yourself and for your kids at home that help decrease anxiety, and when might you want to get professional help, and if you did get professional help, what would be some of the ways that professionals might help you or your child? Okay, so hopefully that's what you expected to hear about tonight. And we're going to get started by just hearing what somebody with an anxiety disorder says it feels like.
From the outside, it's easy to think that somebody's got it all figured out. Because my hair is curled and my cheeks are intentionally flushed, I must not have a care in the world. As if it were expected for my demons to be worn like a scarlet letter pinned to my chest. And they assume if you cannot see it, then it's not really there. As if pain does not exist unless you're bleeding or slung in a cast or staggering with a limp. But sometimes the most painful demons are the ones they can't even see. So we learn how to smile, how to grin and bear it, because nobody likes to talk about the tough stuff. Hell, I don't like to talk about the tough stuff. I have anxiety. It feels like every cell in my body is moving so fast that my veins are blurry, that despite the constant metronome of my heartbeat inside my ears, it's like listening to a spastic drumline. It feels like bees in my ears, like a broken white noise machine playing all of the sounds at once, and I don't even realize I'm gritting my teeth or cracking my knuckles or rubbing my forefinger against my pinky or twisting the gold band on my middle finger, holding onto myself like I'm the only lifeline bridging the gap between reality on my own two feet and the atomically loud abyss of noises and sounds and feelings of fleeting rushing through my veins. And I'm avoiding eye contact. Not because I'm not listening to what you're saying, because I'm listening to the sound of my own voice, hoping that through your ears you can't hear that it's two octaves too high and on the verge of breaking because my palms are sweating and I somehow forgot to speak with anything behind my words other than insecurity. My anxiety feels like fire. unexplainably hot and rash and frustrating as I gnaw the inside of my cheek as if the solution to this feeling is buried between my teeth and gums. It feels like drowning, but it feels like burning, and it feels like fucking forever. I imagine my feet moving with trails of dust behind them like those cartoons, because somehow it feels like I'm moving faster than the 60 seconds they've allowed in a minute, all the while I'm just playing catch up on the stopwatch. And it doesn't add up like it did in high school mathematics. I can't carry the one and find the square root of the problem, because most of the time, there is no problem. There's no life or death situation, there's no rhyme or reason, there is just feelings, and I'm feeling all of them at once. Some days are better than others. Some days are worse. But they're just days. And I've got more where they came from.
I just wanted to give credit to the brave woman who put that on YouTube and allowed other people to understand what it's like to have an anxiety disorder. It's, I think, very brave of her to do that. But I also think it's something that people who don't have anxiety kind of underestimate what it feels like. And I know as a psychiatrist, when I first trained, I saw people with psychosis and major depression and substance abuse and things that seemed way more serious to me than anxiety. But the more I've worked in this field and the more I've treated particularly children and teens with anxiety, the more I think it's really where we want to nip mental illness in the bud. And it's a very serious problem for many people. So with that caveat, let's talk about why we have anxiety, because we all have anxiety at some times. Fear and anxiety are natural states. They're important states. They're adaptive states because they help us know when there's dangers out there. And for that reason, our language has thousands of words, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of words to describe various nuances of either fear or anxiety, because we all experience it. It's a helpful thing to have. And in an evolutionary sense, it's been preserved in all mammals, but particularly in humans, because it's part of the system that allows us to survive. So anxiety and fear in and of themselves are not bad. They're helpful to us. They're adaptive. And I'm going to tell a story. I trained at University of Wisconsin-Madison back in the days right after Harry Harlan had done his work with the rhesus monkeys. And some of you, most of you are younger than me, so I don't know if they even teach this anymore. But he did a lot of work with rhesus monkeys, showing that if you don't let baby monkeys be reared by their mothers, they become much more anxious, tense, stressed out, etc. By the time I got there, he was gone, but the people doing his work had continued it, and they had moved this huge colony of rhesus monkeys to a farm about 5 or 10 miles outside of Madison, very rural area. And the monkeys essentially had free range of this huge acreage. And they had started looking at monkeys who were on the high end of anxiety or the low end of anxiety. And they called the high end anxiety monkeys high anxiety monkeys. And they called the low end laid back monkeys. Nothing bothered those monkeys. And at first it looked like they were sailing good. No matter what kind of stressor you gave them, they were resilient, they did it. You know, you could put all sorts of challenges there. Those laid back monkeys, they just looked like the healthiest thing in the world. Whereas the high anxiety monkeys would huddle, they'd get freaked out, they would not deal well with challenges. Until the county decided to build a highway right through the middle of this huge farm, which they did, and they got permission to do that. And as all these trucks were coming through and the regular construction stuff, those poor little anxiety monkeys, they were up in the barn huddled and barely came out of the barn to get their food. But the laid-back monkeys were out playing on the tractors and the trucks and the bulldozers. And pretty soon, about 3/4 of the laid-back monkeys were dead because they were exploring all this fun stuff in times that got them killed by it. So there's a reason why evolution has kept the genes that make some mammals in a group more anxious than others. And if you think about the arts, there's many places in the arts where you can see that benefit. So for those of you who read Watership Down or saw, I think it's a movie now, there was a very nervous little rabbit in this warren that was always freaking out. But he had a premonition that there was going to be trouble and that the warren had to move. And in fact, he was right, because they were going to bulldozer where that warren was as well. In Wages of Fear, which is a great classic black and white movie, Henri Georges Clouzot is one of Hitchcock's heroes. And so when I was into Hitchcock, I started watching these. It was a group of drivers in, I think, Puerto Rico or not sure where in Central America, but they were paid a lot of money to drive nitroglycerin over the mountain. And the whole movie is about them driving these trucks, knowing that every time they hit a rut or a bump, the whole truck could blow up, and how different people coped with that. And it was actually the most anxious person who got his truck through safely, and many of the others were killed. So even though for the person with an anxiety disorder, there's a lot of pain, like the woman we saw, for society, there's some benefit to having some people who are more on the anxious end. And I think that's why the genes that predict for anxiety get conserved over time. Now, what we want with anxiety is what I call the Goldilocks theory. If you have too little anxiety, you might get killed like those rhesus monkeys. If you're a kid in school and you don't get anxious enough for tests or homework, you might not do very well, unless you're brilliant. But if you have to apply yourself, you might not do so well. You could think of a lot in your own life. If you're just too laid back about something, things might not get done. Or you could have too high anxiety. Obviously, the woman in the beginning, you know, she was suffering a lot with her anxiety disorder. And too high of anxiety, kids freeze up on tests. They can't do their tests. They might not do their homework because they get so worried about having it done perfectly that they can't even get started. So you really want the just right amount of anxiety where performance is at the highest. And this is true in athletics. It's true in academics. It's true in most areas of performance. Most musicians, artists, or you know, theater people will tell you they want to get revved up. They want to be a little anxious before a performance because that makes them perform better. But they don't want to have stage fright. They don't want to go over the edge. One of the newest concepts in neuroscience that's helping us understand this is really making a distinction between fear versus anxiety. Because as we're learning more about circuits in the brain, they actually are overlapping circuits, but they're different circuits. So fear is really a very automatic, reflexive response. And fear, that fear circuit has been around in reptiles, it's been around in lower mammals, it's been around for eons of evolution. And it's because that's what protects you. If you're walking down a path and a snake runs in front of you, you want to have an immediate startle response. So you alert and you decide what you're going to do. Anxiety is a little bit different. Anxiety is more like this endless sense of dread or worry about something that might happen in the future. The woman in the video clip had a little bit of both. You know, when she said, you know, what am I worried about? I don't know what I'm worried about. There's no immediate danger. My thoughts are just going over and over. But part of why she was having those was her body was telling her, you're in a fearful state. Her heart was pounding fast, she was breathing fast, she had this buzzing kind of confusion in her head. Those are all symptoms from the fear circuit. When you're afraid, when you get that fear circuit, it does a couple things automatically, even before you're conscious of what you're worried about. You start getting worried thoughts, you start getting a lot of physical sensations that tell you that you're fearful, and you do fear behaviors. So you've all heard of the flight or fight reflex. It's part of our sympathetic nervous system that it gets triggered when there's a danger or a threat in the environment. And when that happens, your body puts out a lot of adrenaline. It makes your heart beat faster. It makes your muscles tense up so that they're ready to start running. It causes you to breathe more deeply because that's going to bring oxygen so that you're really ready to fight or you're ready to flee the situation. Or in some lower animals like rabbits, which we all have everywhere in our yards right now, you can tell if they're afraid. Sometimes they just freeze and they play dead. And that's all part of that sympathetic response system, okay? The fear brain is, there's a lot of different circuits that do that. So there's a circuit that might detect threats. You know, it might help you see that there's a snake in the road, or it might help you notice that a car is coming towards you. There's also a behavioral, defensive behavior. So once that threat is detected, another circuit puts in place all these things we've been talking about. And then there's physiological adjustments that happen, like the pounding heart or the sweatiness or the moving the muscles. To have an anxiety disorder, you can have problems in any one of those circuits. So your detection of threats may be too high. It may be that things that are not really threats become threats to you. I mean, I'm talking to you as an audience. I really don't think this is a dangerous situation. I don't think you're going to hurt me or anything. I'm not going to fall off the stage. But if I had stage fright or I was fearful of speaking, it would feel like this is a life and death situation. So people with that are misperceiving the level of threat that they're actually in. Defensive behaviors might be too twitchy as well. So you might notice threats appropriately, but your body overreacts with over-twitchiness to that. People who have post-traumatic stress disorder, who've been in traumatic situations and have that kind of anxiety, this is often what's going on for them. It doesn't take very much to trigger a hyper-alert response in them. And then the physiologic adjustments can sometimes go on even without people knowing that they're afraid. So I spent 14 years working at National Jewish, which is an international referral center for people with all sorts of breathing problems, and treated a CEO, very successful guy, who was having trouble with something we call vocal cord dysfunction, where he would have trouble breathing and it would make his body get very tense and sweaty and his heart would pound and everything. And when we told him, well, that's really a variant of panic disorder, he said, you guys are nuts. You need a better PR person, because nobody wants to have panic disorder. Nobody wants that name. And what he had was this physiologic response. It was due to a lung problem, but it made him feel panicky, even though he knew in his brain nothing was going wrong. Okay, so you can have problems in any of these areas. Some of the things, as we just talked about, that pounding heart, that muscle tension, feeling sweaty, being nauseous, some of those things can get conditioned. So if you're a child who was thrown in a pool and didn't know how to swim and you became very afraid of being in water, you could get conditioned to thinking that being in a pool or a lake is something really scary. And even the thought of it can make you have this kind of response, okay? But there's another circuit in the brain, this anxiety circuit, that somewhat takes up with what the fear circuit is doing, but it can also generate conscious thoughts. So I know I went over some of this at a prior talk, so I didn't put them in this talk because I figured there'd be a lot of people here that heard my last one. But I'm just going to briefly tell you, there's a theory about the brain of how it evolved, that there's something called the very old brain, a reptilian brain that even reptiles had. And the fear circuit is in that part of the brain. The newer, slightly newer brain came in called the limbic brain, and that was for mammals. There's a lot of attachment, some basic moods and emotions came in. If you think about mammals, they take care of their young. If young are away from the mother, both the mother and the young have a reasonable fear because of that separation. So that's part of this fear system. In humans, that's all non-conscious. It all happens without your conscious awareness of it. What humans brought on is the newer cortex brain, which actually has thoughts. You can think about the future. You can evaluate one thing versus another thing. You have this conscious ability to think about things. And in that circuit is an anxiety circuit. And that's what can go awry when you have anxiety. So it can be triggered by physiologic fear circuits, but it can just go on its own accord. So you could be a worrier who's worried about, what college am I going to get into? What college am I going to get to? I'm never going to get into a good college. And your body can feel perfectly calm, but that anxiety circuit is what's overworking. Okay, so what it looks like in the brain, this is a human brain on the left. There's a little rodent brain on the right. They're much smaller brains. And you could see proportionately, the yellow part on the right part of the brain, if you see that little yellow crescent shape, then there's this little green circle there. That's the amygdala. And the amygdala is the fear center. It's kind of the hub of the fear circuit of the brain. If you look in a rodent brain, that's pretty big compared to the rest of the brain. And that little blue part that's right above it, next to the pink part, is called the BNST, or basal nucleus of the stria terminalis. You don't need to know that. It's very little in a rodent. If you come and look at the human brain, We still have an amygdala, but because we have so much more neocortex, that ability to think, it's not as big proportionately. And we still have that BNST, which is the little blue part above. The BNST is the center of the anxiety hub of the brain. And there are interrelated connections, but they also can operate separately. So people who have damaged amygdalas because of tumors or accidents or something, they don't have those bodily reactions to threats. If they're in a car that looks like it's going to crash, they don't get that pounding heart and that intake of breath and that, you know, tense response that most people get. But they can still be very worried. They can still have anxiety, okay? In healthy people, the amygdala is activated by threats. But in people with anxiety disorders, that activation is way overblown. So a little bit of a threat can go a long way in making them feel much more anxious than they need to. The BNST is the hub of the anxiety circuit. Part of its job is to figure out, is this really a threat or not? And that's partly when things are uncertain. So it's pretty clear if a car's coming towards you, that's a threat. It's a little less clear if you're going to take a math test that week, whether you're really going to fail it or not, probably. Or it's less clear if you're worried about global warming, whether it's going to happen tomorrow or not. Or it's less clear if you're a kid and you're worried about if you're going to make it into the college of your choice. Those are uncertain threats, really. And so this circuit really has to help you figure out how real of a worry is that. Sometimes it's a real worry. If you've not studied for your math test at all and you don't know the material, you should be worried that you're going to have trouble on the test. But most of the time, it's not a real worry. That most of these kids who get overly anxious about tests actually know the material, and it's their BNST that's going wild here. This circuit can make you be behaviorally inhibited. So if you look at very young kids, and most of you have had kids, I think, if you remember back to toddlerhood, when you went to the preschool with your child, you know, there'd be most of the kids would be running around and meeting other kids, and then there'd be some kids who'd be a very kind of slow to warm up and shy, not wanting to get into that group. And it looks like about 15% of kids have that behavioral inhibition, probably genetically from birth. That's one of the risk factors to develop an anxiety disorder. Now, not all of those kids develop anxiety disorders, but it is a risk factor. So it's fairly hardwired right from the beginning. And in those kids, this system is a little bit more active, and that's part of the reason why they're inhibited that way. Okay, so the nice thing about having all this cortex and this new brain is it can overcome the unconscious circuits. So the more you practice doing that, and if you went to my talk on mindfulness, or if you know anything about mindfulness or meditation, the more you strengthen that new brain by taking control of it, the more you're able to say to that fear circuit, you know, slow down. There's really no problem here. We don't have to get worried. We don't have to get overworked. And you can do that. So you can strengthen those circuits of the brain that dampen these automatic responses. So the amygdala processes without being conscious. It just happens, okay? But conscious awareness of a threat triggers a conscious system. And it's just like triggering, if it's freezing cold outside and you don't have enough clothes, that's a pretty reasonable threat that you might have a problem with freezing to death or hypothermia. That's kind of a conscious awareness of synthesizing both the cues from your body and looking at the environment and knowing this is a problem and then deciding to take action. So some anxiety is like that. You can take action and you could decide it's a real threat. So you can have this physiologic symptoms without having a conscious worry. So the woman in the beginning said, there's no reason for me to be anxious. I'm just worried and anxious, but there's really no threat. She had an overactive fear system going on. But you can also have conscious worries without any of those physical symptoms of fear. And those are often more about existential issues. So things about not leading a meaningful life, not having close enough relationships, thinking you're going to die anyway, what's the use, comparing yourself to other people. Does this sound like your teenage kids? I mean, these are common worry thoughts for adolescents. Part of that is developmentally appropriate because they are figuring out what is the meaning in life for them, what is their purpose in this world, what do they want to be. But part of it can go on in a way that's not very productive for them too. Okay, so when do we say these normal fears and these protective fears and anxieties become an anxiety disorder? Well, if the anxiety is really way out of proportion to what the actual threat is, that's one thing. If it's persisting over time, we all get bouts of this where we're overly anxious for a day or two. But if you're anxious, overly anxious, like that woman was in the videotape for 6 months or more, that's probably edging over into a disorder, or it is a disorder, if it causes interference. And the main interference we get is people stop doing things that they're afraid of. So you might have a very talented athlete who develops this fear about performing on the field, and he just stops playing whatever sport he's very good at. That would be an avoidance behavior. Okay? Or it might impair functioning. The fear circuits of the brain are tied in with your gut very closely. So commonly, people who have anxiety disorders often have gut problems, diarrhea, constipation, pain, those kinds of symptoms. They go along with being anxious. That might cause you problems. And generally, if you're worrying more than an hour a day, if it's not a natural disaster or some really huge threat, that's probably pushing it over into an anxiety disorder. So anxiety disorders have been around a long time. This is not just a phenomenon of modern Western life. This is from 1628, and if you read it, it pretty much talks about what we're talking about. People have had these kinds of anxieties for a long time. I'll give you a minute there. But I'm going to talk through some of the anxiety disorders we now recognize and separate in what we call the DSM-5, which is somewhat of our working manual for what are psychiatric disorders. So when you're worrying, even when you have nothing to worry about, that's one of the symptoms, okay? They are one of the most common psychiatric illnesses in both children and adults. Almost a quarter of our population suffers from an anxiety disorder. And you have to think of these chronic anxiety disorders similar to somebody who has diabetes or asthma, that you always have the disorder. You can figure out ways to manage it. You could have it under really good control, and you could have no symptoms for a long time. But it's kind of lurking in the background, okay? Or you can sometimes have symptoms and sometimes not. You know, you can be more or less good, and then you have a very stressful event, and then that anxiety disorder kicks in again. But you really want to think about it, for the most part, as a chronic disorder that people manage better or worse. Half of anxiety disorders start in childhood. And when they start, early onset anxiety disorders, starting before age 15, they are associated with poorer progress in high school or dropping out of high school or college, increased risk of teenage childbearing, increased risk of marital instability, and increased risk of current unemployment. So these are serious problems that have economic and functional consequences later in life if we don't pick them up and treat them in childhood. One of the other risk factors, I talked about this behavioral inhibition, but there's another thing we call anxiety sensitivity, that we all have days where our stomach gurgles, or we get a little twitch in our shoulder, or we get a slight headache, and most of us just go on about our usual day. You might note it, but it doesn't really stop you. People with anxiety sensitivity are extremely sensitive to all those internal stimuli that we call interoceptive symptoms. So they are really aware that their stomach is gurgling, or they're really, really aware that they have a twitch in their shoulder. And not only are they aware of it, but then they start worrying about it, that this must mean something's wrong. Something's wrong with my shoulder. You know, I have a migraine. I have a brain tumor. It can easily spiral out of control. So we call this a fear of fear. People with this kind of anxiety sensitivity, that's a risk factor for developing other kinds of anxiety disorders, okay? But in and of itself, it's not a problem unless it gets over into the realm we've already talked about. That anxiety sensitivity is quite heritable. So about 50% of it comes from your genes. Tends to run in families, therefore. So some people have families that are very aware of these internal stimuli. It's how the parents treat the kids to deal with it and how the kids learn how to deal with it is part of what's going to predict whether they're going to have an anxiety disorder or not. And I had a kid who was oblivious to these physical symptoms to the point that, you know, she had a rip-roaring ear infection and I didn't know it and felt terrible by the time I got her to the pediatrician. And another kid who was overly sensitive to everything. So I've parented both types of kids. And you have to be flexible with your child to know what are their needs. If you have an anxiety-sensitive child, you don't want to encourage that. You want to dampen that. You want to dissuade them from getting too hooked into these kinds of thoughts. So, heritability, we've talked about this behavioral inhibition. That's a risk factor that's fairly heritable, as is anxiety. Actual disorders have a lower rate of heritability, in part because there's a gene and environment interaction here. So not everybody with the genetic susceptibility is going to develop an anxiety disorder based on what's happening to them in their environment. Okay? But if you have a first-degree relative who has an anxiety disorder, say a parent, that child will have a 3 to 5-fold increased risk of having an anxiety disorder. Does that make sense, everybody? Okay, so what we call shared genetics differentiate different disorders. So I think Carol mentioned I've done some behavioral genetics research and work, and basically kind of the cornerstone of behavioral genetics is you look at identical twins who share 99.9% of their genes versus fraternal twins who share 50% of their genes. But usually everything else in their environment is pretty well controlled for. They live in the same house, they have the same toxins in their environment, they have the same in utero environment, et cetera, et cetera. So if one twin has an anxiety disorder, you look at what's the chance their other twin has it. And if it's higher in identical twins than it is in fraternal twins, then you know that's due to their genes. That's kind of how we sort this out. And if you look at large samples of twins, what we found out is that the same genes that predict for generalized anxiety disorder also predict for major depression. So it's the same genetic susceptibility for both of those illnesses. And what differentiates which one you have is what happens to you in the environment. If nothing bad happens, you don't get either disorder. If you have trauma or neglect, those kinds of stressors usually lead to anxiety. If you have a loss, like a parent dies in childhood, or your parents get divorced, something like that, or you have a chronic illness, then they tend to lead to depression. But not surprisingly, a lot of people who have depression also have anxiety because of this factor, that you can have both of these things going on, so they often occur together. And that's one of the reasons why the Depression Center is interested in anxiety disorders, because in kids, usually the anxiety shows up first, and we try to prevent it from going into depression. Panic disorder, phobias, social anxiety, PTSD, they have a different set of genes that predict for them, and they're different from the ones that predict for this generalized anxiety. So we've talked about what happens in the environment. So social learning. If you're in a family where whenever you get a headache, your parents freak out and call the doctor and take you in, and they're very worried about you, and they go on and on about that, that's going to encourage you to be anxious whenever you have one of these interoceptive cues. Or if your parents do that for themselves, you're going to learn that when you have something wrong with your body, you have to really be worried about it. That's what I mean by social learning. You see other people, or you have a parent who's afraid of going out where there's a lot of people, social anxiety, so you don't have a lot of people at your house, you're not brought to places where there's a lot of people, you don't learn how do you do it when you're out with a lot of people, so you develop social anxiety too. So there's a fair amount of that. We talked about early neglect. There's now some research that mothers that are stressed while they're pregnant, so they've looked at mothers who survived famine or wars or natural disasters during pregnancy, and then they look at their offspring. Those offspring tend to have a hyperactive stress system. It's called the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal system. I don't want to get into all the biology, but it's a system that'll trigger cortisol responses. And it tends to be twitchier in those kids whose mothers were stressed a lot during pregnancy. Okay? And then over-accommodating parenting, so kind of the helicopter parents that we've all talked about. If you're always trying to protect your child from everything that could possibly upset them, they never learn how to just get on and do it, and that actually encourages more anxiety development. So those are the environmental factors. So again, it's half genetic, half environmental, and there's this interaction that determines whether you're going to have a problem or not. So when you have an anxiety disorder, these are some of the symptoms you have. And if you notice, a lot of these are things kids might complain about that you wouldn't naturally think of anxiety. So I have a stomach ache. I can't go to school. I feel sick to my stomach. I'm nauseated. Or I have a headache. Or I just can't concentrate, you know, I can't think straight. You're thinking, well, either they have the flu or they have ADHD, but actually these can all be symptoms of anxiety. And the more severe of the anxiety, the more you see things like this poor concentration or poor memory. So interestingly, ADHD and anxiety also go together. So when you have younger kids, if they have both, often just treating the anxiety will reduce their problems with concentration and they will no longer meet criteria for ADHD. Not always, but often. Okay, this is exhausting. People with anxiety are exhausted all the time, and it's because all this stuff is going on we don't see. Like the woman said, this is constantly in their heads, even though they look normal, they're really fighting a battle, okay? And as I said before, half of anxiety disorders begin before the age of 15, so very common. This is a little girl with behavioral inhibition. This picture on the right was drawn by a 12-year-old I was treating for anxiety, and I said, well, draw me a picture of what it feels like. And this is what her day in school felt like, that everybody was their heads were getting cut off on the guillotine. Those are all dead heads on the left. And hers was the next one up. And she had that feeling all day long. Not surprisingly, she didn't want to go to school. I mean, it was a pretty scary place for her. These are the DSM-5 anxiety disorders that we talk about. And I'm sure many of you have read about these or seen these or heard these. So we're going to play a little guessing game, okay? So look at these. And I'm going to show you a picture or two, and I want the audience to guess which anxiety disorder it is, all right? I'm not going to tell you much about them until we get to them. All right, the worrier pose. Is everyone looking at me? Does my body look weird in this top? Should I get chips for dinner? Am I happy? What do I want? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. What do you think this is? What kind of anxiety disorder? Generalized. Good. RSVP to all the hours of sleep I've lost to overthinking everything. Generalized anxiety, okay? Why is trying to dig a hole, or worry is like trying to dig a hole in water. It can keep you really busy, but you accomplish nothing. So generalized anxiety is unrealistic worry that lasts more than 6 months, that takes up at least an hour a day, about everything. About the future, about how other people think about you, of how you're going to perform, whether you're going to be on time, whether there's going to be a tornado. It could be a lot of various worries, okay? 2 to 10% of the population have this. It's fairly common. Typically starts in late elementary, early middle school, and it's more common in girls than boys, and you have all those physical symptoms as another diagnostic criteria. We talked about headaches, stomach aches, that kind of thing. Okay, what do you think? I'm going to give you two for this one. This is your first clue. This is your second clue. Worried about, afraid you'll say or do the wrong thing. What kind of anxiety do you think this is? Social anxiety, good. So people with social anxiety, or it used to be called social phobia, sometimes called SAD, really worry about social situations. They don't like to eat in school because they don't like people watching them eat. They don't like to meet new people. They're worried that people are going to not like them. They're going to make fun of them. They have a lot of physical symptoms. They freeze up if they have to meet new people. They get very tense. It's actually not that common in childhood, but the ones that start in childhood tend to remit. It doesn't mean you might not want to help kids with it, but by and large, if it starts early on, these behavioral inhibited kids, often parents can work with them and gently encourage them to just do things, join a group, have a friend over until you get used to them. And about 86% of the time, they remit. A more pernicious form starts in teenage years, 13 to 17. So a kid who's been fine, social all along, and then hits middle school or high school and suddenly starts developing these symptoms, that is actually a much tougher form of social anxiety to treat, and that's the one that has a lot of those risk factors. If you're afraid to go to school because you're afraid of what people think about you, you're probably not going to do as well academically. You may or may not be able to get to college. You may or may not get a good job. You can kind of see how those things start building up. So that's a difficult one, and that's equally common in males and females. All right. What's this? Phobias, great. So spiders, heights, flying, snakes, various things. Specific phobias, a really intense fear of a specific issue. And it could be anything. Could be dogs, heights, you know. We've heard of a lot of these phobias, claustrophobia, agoraphobia, etc. The level of fear is inappropriate to what the issue is. And these typically start in childhood, 7 to 9 years old. It's pretty common to have elementary school kids who are freaked out by spiders or bees or this or that. Most kids get over it and outgrow it. Some kids always have that fear. We don't really think you need to treat it until they start avoiding doing things. So I treated a boy who had a phobia about hornets. And this, he was 10 years old, he was a good basketball player. He refused to play hoops with his friends because the basketball hoop in the neighborhood was near a tree where the hornets hung out. He was deathly afraid he was going to get bitten by a hornet. When summer came on, he would refuse to go outside because hornets could fly in the backyard, he might get bitten. He wouldn't go outside with his friends. So when it became that big of a problem, we actually had to treat the phobia. Now the good news is, if people are willing to treat it, it's very treatable, and we can talk about that later, but you can get over it. But for the most part, many people might have these, and they kind of stay the same over time, unless you really work at trying to get rid of it. Okay, some more clues. OCD, okay, so needing everything to be exactly right. That's one of the things, but you know, really to diagnose the true OCD disorder is really intrusive thoughts that you don't want, obsessive thoughts, you know. Did I turn off the lights? Did I turn off the lights? Did I turn off the stove? Do I have to lock the doors? Over and over and over again. Often the obsessive thoughts are about things like germs. Am I going to get sick because I touched a desk that somebody else coughed on? Can I use a bathroom because somebody else is in there and I might get infected from it? Aggression, you know, I'm afraid to drive because I'm worried I'm going to drive into somebody and kill them. They're unrealistic kind of obsessions and compulsive. So we've heard about hand washing. If you're obsessing about germs and dying from germs, you might be washing your hands all day long until your hands are red and raw. Or hair pulling, that's a form of this OCD. Needing to order things all the time, check on things, those are the behaviors. About 2 to 2.5% of the population have this. And the mean age of onset is 10 years old. OCD as a disorder is different than obsessive tendencies or obsessive personality. I would say 80% of people who make it through medical school have obsessive personality because it's helpful for you. You like to memorize lists, you like to check things off. Airline pilots are similar. You know, some of that can be very adaptive. This is when it's not adaptive, when it goes over into causing you a lot of internal pain or just eats up all your day. I mean, it's not unusual for somebody with OCD to spend 4 or 5 hours a day washing and rewashing, checking, reordering, those kinds of behaviors. There's a specific subset of OCD some people may have heard of. The current name is PANDAS, which is not just for OCD, but it's pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with streptococcal infections. So you've all heard of rheumatic fever, which is actually an autoimmune response that certain people get if they have a streptococcal infection. This, you can also have an OCD response to a streptococcal infection. And it's more typical, there's a test that identifies if you're susceptible to it. But the clinical story is the kid is fine, they have a bad strep throat, suddenly they're doing all these OCD things. It eventually subsides, they're fine, they have another strep throat, and it starts up again. It's a fairly rare form of OCD, I will say. There are tests for it, but we treat this one with antibiotics usually to get it better. Okay, another anxiety disorder. Can't breathe, my heart is pounding, I'm shivering, my muscles are tight, I think I'm gonna die. What do you think this is? Panic disorder, great. I really don't like going outside, it's too people-y out there. This is panic disorder's sister component, which is called agoraphobia, not wanting to go where there are people, okay? Not everybody with panic disorder has agoraphobia, but they often go together. So recurrent or unexpected panic attacks with these symptoms, okay? All these physical symptoms and fear that you're either going crazy or you're gonna die, something awful's happening. Many people go to the ER when they have a panic attack if they don't know what it is. And this is actually a cost of medical usage that's unnecessary, because if panic disorder is diagnosed and treated, we don't have to have people going to ER getting all these expensive tests that usually come back negative. It's uncommon in children. It's much more common in adults. So for example, 0.6% of adolescents might have it. You almost never see it in kids younger than 12. But there is a form of separation anxiety that's kind of like it. 1.5 to 3.5% of adults have it. This was my CEO man who didn't feel like he was worried, but he'd have all these physical symptoms. He had a variant of panic disorder. You can be very successful with this once you know what it is and you don't freak out, and you can treat it by breathing exercises. But if you don't know what it is and you start associating, all right, I had that panic attack, I was in the mall, I better not ever go to the mall again because something about the mall made me really worried. Or I had that panic attack while I was driving, I better not ever drive again. You start avoiding things. That's really when it becomes problematic. And in the extreme, people don't even want to go out of their house because they don't know where or when they're going to get a panic attack. That's what we call agoraphobia. All right. Separation anxiety. Excessive concern about being away from caregivers, usually parents. Kids will fear that if they're in school, something bad might happen to their mom or dad, so they better not go to school because they're worried about their mom or dad. They want to be with them, making sure everything's okay. Or something bad will happen to them if they're away from their mom or dad. Or if dad is on a business trip, they are freaked out the whole time because they're worried that dad won't get back safely. Those are the kind of common fears for kids with this. It's fairly common in younger children, 2 to 5%. It's still common in adolescents, more common in girls. Often a stressor will start it, but not always. Okay, so this is separation anxiety. Now this one, these are traumas. You could have a single trauma, like a tornado or a flood or a fire or seeing somebody get run over by a truck, those kinds of things. Or you can have ongoing traumas. Conflict in the home, marriage, you know, marital conflict where the parents are constantly fighting and bickering and it never gets resolved. That's actually a huge stressor for kids. Obviously, child abuse on them is a huge chronic stressor. Kids that live in dangerous neighborhoods, huge chronic traumas, okay? So you can have different kinds of stress disorders. We call it an acute stress disorder within 1 month of the trauma. And symptoms can occur for up to 1 month after, and they are more like dissociative symptoms, feeling numbed out, feeling fuzzy, not connected to people, sometimes actually having amnesia. I don't know if you all remember the Challenger explosion, which happened, can't remember when, but when it happened, in the early 90s, I think, there was a lot of hoopla. I mean, all these elementary schools were actually following that because that was the first time a teacher was going to be an astronaut in space, if you remember. So they were following this teacher, and a lot of third and fourth grade classes were watching it on the news. There was a study done of a small town in New England that actually watched the Challenger live on TV or in real time on TV and saw it explode. And they were matched with another small town in California where they didn't see it in real time because it happened out of their time zone, but they heard about it later. And kids can actually get traumatized by having this, what we call secondary trauma, watching something traumatic on TV, knowing about it, even though they weren't in it. So we have really good data from that because the researcher, Lenore Taird, actually followed these kids and teenagers from the time of the Challenger exploding forward prospectively. And for the first month, these kinds of symptoms were actually pretty common. And in teenagers, even auditory and verbal auditory hallucinations and visual hallucinations were common, like feeling that there were ghosts in the room, seeing ghosts in the room, hearing someone call their name, not knowing what it was. Those were these dissociative symptoms of an acute stress reaction. And for most kids, they died down and went away, but we had a real dose response effect. So the closer you were to the trauma, like if you watched it on TV, or if you were from the school district where that teacher was, you had much higher rates of trauma. If it was more distant, you had some, but lower rates. This is one of the reasons we really don't like kids watching repeated traumas on school, like school shootings, Oklahoma bombing, 911. Adults can get traumatized from that too, but kids can really get traumatized from watching too much traumatic news, okay? It becomes a post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, if the symptoms go on past a month. Okay? That's the main difference, really. The physical symptoms are very similar. So these are just some of the things that can be triggered, that can trigger it. Something like 67% of adults report that they've had a traumatic event in their life, retrospectively. So the traumas themselves are fairly common. PTSD is not so common. So there are risk factors for who gets stuck with it. But if you do get stuck with it, these are the kind of symptoms you might have, either for an acute trauma, acute stress reaction, or post-traumatic. Poor sleeping, poor concentration, this emotional numbing or detachment from others. A couple that I want to point out to you as parents of teenagers. So say your teen's friend gets killed in a car accident or overdoses or something. These things happen. They might blame themselves. They might blame other people for not protecting that child. They lose their sense of purpose, and they're pessimistic about the future. These are reactions to having been traumatized. So sometimes kids are brought to us saying, you know, they used to be a great student, now they just don't care, they have no motivation. When I talk to the child, say they're 15, they don't think they're going to live beyond 20 because their friends died, and they don't think they're going to get beyond that. So those are the kinds of symptoms you get with this kind of traumatic reaction. Okay, these are some more PTSD ideas: anger, anxiety, insomnia, nightmares, frightening thoughts, intrusive thoughts, memories of what happened, sometimes reliving it. We call that flashbacks, as though it's actually happening. You're seeing your friend in the car accident again and again. It's a real physical injury. If you look at the brains of people who don't have PTSD and compare them to the brains of people with diagnosed PTSD, you can see their brains shrink. You can see different areas. They're losing some of their neural connections because of this illness. All right, those are the bad news. So on the other hand, how can you prevent all this? What can you do for yourself or your kids so that normal fear and anxiety doesn't have to get out of hand? So we're going to switch gears a little bit. The old way was you just tough it out. And there's some benefit to this old way. I mean, you get up, you force yourself to get up, you force yourself to put one foot in front of the other, and goddammit, you refuse to let it get to you, you fight and you cry. That just do it has some merit to it, that as we get into what actually gets people better, doing the thing that you're afraid of actually does help, but it doesn't have to be quite this hard as it used to be. And we don't have to be quite so closed in about it. So, you know, how not to be hard on yourself, how to teach your child not to be hard on themselves. Those are good things to do. So every single problem you have is not unique. You're not the only person in the world whose best friend ever said that they don't like you. That really happens to other people. So you don't have to be that hard on yourself. It's not that you're the worst kid. Or accept your weaknesses as your features. Okay, so you're a little quirky. You're not good at sports, but you really like art. That's what's really unique and wonderful about you. That's a good thing. Don't underestimate your talent until you apply it 100 times. So I tried it and I'm no good at it. Well, you know, you need to try it. You need to work at it for a while before you decide whether you're good at it or not. So keep trying it. So these are just some common sense things as to how to help your kids get through the day when things come up for them. You give your kids support for trying. You know, you're brave for doing that, even though it made you scared or it made you anxious. You really didn't want to go off that high dive, and look, you went off of it. Good for you. So what if you belly flopped or you went feet first? You did it. That's what's going to get you feeling more confident that you could do it again. Put things in perspective. You know, this my most common phrase for teenagers is, you know, if you peak in high school, you're not going to be so great by the time you're 30. That most people who are really successful in this world do not peak in high school. They peak later in life. So if you're not the most popular kid in high school, that's not the end of the world. You know, it's not your final destination. You might still grow to be something different and better when you get out of high school. Helping them put it in perspective. That's one advantage we older folks have, is we've kind of seen how this works over years. And we know that the person who is the prom queen or king may not always be the most successful person. Now, maybe they will, but there's an old 90s movie called Peggy Sue Got Married, which is on Netflix, I'm sure. If you haven't watched it and you have a kid who's worried about this, it's a great movie to watch with your high school student because it kind of puts things in perspective. Take care of yourself. You know, what do you need to feel good? Do you need time with your friends? Do you just need time alone where you're by yourself? Do you need to speak up? Do you need a cup of coffee? Do you want to just geek out and do something really goofy? Do you need rest? You know, but building these kinds of things into your kids' schedules and helping them know that they don't have to be busy 24/7. It's good to take care of themselves and build up that other part of their body. Slow things down. You know, if you were at my talk on mindfulness, you know, being mindful, taking minutes just to appreciate the day and being quiet with it is actually very, very helpful to prevent anxiety and to treat anxiety. Talk about it. Share thoughts. And so because you're the parents, I'm telling you how to listen. I mean, just try to understand what your child's telling you. It's very hard to do. You know, just listen, repeat back what you hear, respect their thoughts, don't tell them how to solve it, don't interrupt, don't give advice unless they ask you for it. Just listen to them and be supportive. That's really helpful for kids. Gratitude is actually one of the emotions you can cultivate that's scientifically been shown to reduce anxiety. So there's a group, and I talked about this before, but there's a group called HeartMath that has this kind of biofeedback system that they've helped primary responders like police and firemen and people after a trauma relax their body so they don't develop these PTSD or acute stress symptoms. And the main way they get people into this state of relaxation is they have them focus on their heart and think about a person that they're really grateful for, somebody that they really appreciate being in their life. And if you do that simple thing, or you could be grateful for a variety of things, but particularly people in your life, if you take a minute to just be really grateful for people in your life that are important to you, that actually gets you into this physiologic state of deep relaxation, which helps prevent anxiety. So this is good news for all of us. Before you get out of bed, express your gratitude, take 5 slow, deep breaths, which also gets you to that calmer state. Decide what you want to do that day. Forgive yourself if you did something yesterday that you weren't so proud of, and then smile and get up. And it sounds simple, but helping your teen do that is actually a really nice routine for them to get started with their day. Okay, what if you can't do it alone or your teen can't do it alone? This says, I wouldn't be like this if I knew how to not be like this, okay? So sometimes the anxiety is so severe, all these good tries, you know, just aren't enough to do it. And people have a real anxiety disorder. There's no need to suffer silently, and there's no shame in seeking help. And I think more and more people are coming out now to say, mental health problems are really common. I mean, 1 in 5 people in the United States has had a serious mental health problem, meaning it's lasted at least 3 months and caused them impairment at some point in their life. So 1 in 5 people, that means all of us, if you think about your parents, your siblings, and your kids, you probably have at least 5 people in your family. Probably at least statistically one of them has had a serious mental health problem. So Carl Menninger, who founded the Menninger Institute, a very prestigious and premier psychiatric institute, he would say the percentage of American families that have had an experience with mental health problems is 100%. And I think that's true. So why we have to make it a stigma, I don't know. It makes it worse. When I was a kid, cancer was stigmatized. I had an uncle who died of cancer. Nobody ever mentioned the word cancer. I didn't know he had cancer until I went to medical school and looked up his records, which you could do in those days. can't do that anymore. But I think part of why we have these national depression centers now is one of the things that got cancer to be destigmatized was cancer centers of excellence. First of all, you said the word out loud. You went to that center because you wanted to get treated for it. And you know what? The more people started treating it, the better they got at treating it. And actually, we cure many, or we at least put into remission, many cancers today. Not all of them, but a good deal of them. And I think the same thing is true for mental health. So I'm a proponent of treating it equally as any other illness, talking about it, getting treatment for it. I think it improves treatment, and I think it doesn't need to be stigmatized. But that's my thing. So if your child's not doing so well, get a really good assessment, because there could be other underlying causes for it. There might be trauma you don't know about. They may have been bullied and they haven't told you about it. get a good family history, again, to assess what are the genetic risks. We want to know, have there been other people in the family with these problems? Some genetic testing is useful. We use one that actually helps us decide what medication to use, and I'll tell you about that later. Understanding what are the strengths and challenges in a more systematic way, and looking for other comorbidities that might be causing anxiety, like ADHD. Anxiety can be induced by a lot of substances or illnesses, so this is one of the things we do in a good assessment. And I'll point out caffeine, including Red Bull and all sorts of things that kids drink. That is one of the main culprits in panic disorder, so just cutting out caffeine can often be helpful. Alcohol, marijuana, those things can make you more anxious. Obviously, other kinds of medical problems, vitamin deficiencies. You want to make sure none of these things are going on or treat them. And if you do use substances, when you withdraw from substances, anxiety is a common symptom of withdrawal. So that can also be a problem. There are many places out there that do brain imaging. Brain imaging is a wonderful research tool that we are learning more and more about these circuits. It's not yet ready for prime time. So don't waste your $2,200 or $2,500 on getting your child's brain scan, because it really does not have the science behind it yet to be useful. You're much better off seeing a reputable psychiatrist or psychologist and getting a good assessment. So, treatment options. Psychoeducation is one of them. You're doing that right now, which is great. Know what you're dealing with, know what some of the options are. I'll talk about medications in a bit. Cognitive behavioral therapy is kind of our go-to for that anxiety part of it, the worry part. Medications are great at the fear response. They dampen the fear response. They bring down that physiologic revved upness or hyperarousal. They're not very good at the chronic worries. Therapy is really good at the chronic worries. And so if you have both fear and anxiety, you probably need both medications and therapy. The biggest part of therapy is exposure response prevention. I'm going to talk about that. But relaxation therapies, things like getting massages, like slow deep breathing, Tai Chi, yoga, those kinds of things that help you relax, those are actually very good. Mindfulness is very good. Family therapy. Remember I talked about, you know, the helicopter parent or the over-hovering parent? That's not so good for a kid with an anxiety disorder. So sometimes we need family therapy to kind of separate what's going on for the child, what's going on for the parent. And a lot of parents I see, they're more anxious about their child's success or performance than the child is, and that's driving some of this pattern. So sorting that out and helping everybody take a deep breath and step back is often very useful. Okay, so this is, it's so bizarre how in this world, if you have asthma and you take asthma meds, you take asthma medications. If you have diabetes, you take diabetes medication. But as soon as you have to take medicine for your mind, there's such a stigma behind it, what I talked about before. But medications are very useful for anxiety. Probably our mainstay medications are what we call the SSRIs, things like Prozac or Zoloft or Celexa. You've probably heard about those. There are older antidepressants that work really well, particularly for OCD, that we use. There are other kinds of antidepressants that are helpful, things like trazodone or bupropion. We use Buspar, which is a non-addictive, non-dependence-forming medication. That's often helpful. You can use that one like Tylenol. Antidepressants, typically you have to take every day for 4 to 6 weeks before they really kick in. So that's a hard thing to do. You're taking this pill every day, you're not necessarily feeling better right away. Things like Buspar are kind of like Tylenol. You take it, you feel better, and then it's out of your system, and you'd have to take another one. So there are times and places we use both of those. Benzodiazepines, things like Xanax or Valium, I almost never use in kids, and I'll tell you why. I mean, I might use it if a child's parent died. I might use it to get them through a week. But for the most part, I don't use it because, one, they're addictive. They can be dependent forming, so you don't want to get a kid on a medication that they're going to use the rest of their life. And two, they inhibit the growth of new learning, which is the main way the brain recovers from anxiety. So these are not good. If you're seeing somebody who says, your kid's anxious, I'm going to give them Xanax, you know, really question that. They're good in a very short-term acute uses. And short-term, I mean 2 to 3 weeks, never more than a month. Certainly not more than a month, okay? beta blockers, MAOIs. So we have a lot of different tools that we can use to help with anxiety. This is this GeneSight test I told you about. What we've been doing at the depression centers, we now know the genes that predict how your body metabolizes these various medications, because there are literally probably 100 of them we could pick from. So how do you know which one is right for your child or for you? This will at least tell you which ones your body metabolizes normally, which will come out in that green column, which one your body either doesn't metabolize, or the FDA has said that because you have this genetic type, it's contraindicated for you. Those are in the red column. You really want to avoid those. And then those that are in the middle, that maybe you need to have a lower dose or a higher dose, and then they'll work for you. And studies done with adults, most of the studies so far have been done with adults. We're in the process of analyzing data on kids that we collected at Children's Hospital. If you randomize large groups of adults, like at Kaiser or the VA when they've done this, and if the physician has this information at the start of treatment, people get better quicker, they have fewer side effects, they need fewer medication changes and fewer physician visits. So it actually saves money in a large population. For any one person, we can't guarantee that. Maybe everything you have is in the green column. I will say at a tertiary referral center like the Depression Center, when we get people coming to us, often they've had two or three medicines that have failed. When we get this test, they often have a very skewed profile, like one or two in their green column, and many that aren't working for them in their red column. So I've almost gone with doing this test ahead of time, even if it's the first time that I'm prescribing a medication, just because you save time. You hate to waste 2 months of your or your child's time on a medication that's not going to work, or they're going to get side effects, and then they're going to get discouraged, and then you have to start all over again. I would rather just have a roadmap up front and know what I'm doing. But that's an option. But like I said, medications are only half the story. They deal really well with that fear system. They don't do much for that anxiety system. So therapy is your other option. And most often, we recommend both. So if you started just meds or just therapy, at 4 months, people, kids with anxiety will be equally well. But if you start them both at the same time, at 4 months, they're better, and they get better quicker. So usually it's a synergy, and we try to do both together. There's different kinds of therapies, but the mainstay, first of all, you do want to help people understand what level of threat. That's the cognitive behavioral therapy. So you're really worried about this, but really, why should you be worried about it? You know, you're worried you're going to have a tornado that's going to kill you and your family. Well, how realistic is that? You know, do you see any tornadoes out here? I mean, how often does Denver get tornadoes? You can use kind of a rational cognitive approach to fight those worries. But the real mainstay is, well, so this is how you think. So the cognitive behavioral therapy, a lot of what it does is challenge the kind of thoughts people have that get them more worried. Because the more you practice worrying, the better you're going to get at worrying, and the more those worry circuits of your brain are going to get really, really strong, and that's your default. The more you practice fighting those worries, the less often you're going to worry. So sometimes just changing your thinking. But really, exposure therapy is what actually gets people through it. So that Nike thing of just do it. Facing something you're afraid of, getting through it, and having nothing bad happen. That's what we call exposure therapy, response prevention. That is the single best kind of treatment for anxiety disorders. And the other kinds of therapies we use help people get ready to do this, because it's not easy. If you're really anxious about something, you're not going to want to go face that fear. So we give you all sorts of tools to kind of prime yourself, and we start with little fears to build up your confidence that this works. But really, this is what ultimately works. It's the extinction. So you can think about when you have a fear or worry in your brain, that neural circuit gets overutilized. It's almost like a rut in your brain. Every time you see a hornet, you're going to go into this fear circle. And it becomes the default. And you can't just erase those. So the only way you recover from it is you have that exposure and you have something different happen. So your brain puts down new pathways. I saw a hornet and nothing happened. I saw a hornet and I didn't get stung. My friend played basketball next to a hornet and nothing happened. Those kinds of new learning pathways are what gets rid of the fear. And that's the part I said, if you take benzodiazepines like Xanax, it inhibits that new learning, which is one of the reasons we don't like to use those. Okay? There's some new novel treatments for this fear circuit. Because it's an unconscious circuit, some people are just primed to see the negative in a situation or see the scary part in a situation. And there's some new computer programs that actually untrain that, which are kind of interesting and cool. So we could talk about that if you're interested. But mostly, it's if you're going to get treatment, you know, accept that you have an anxiety disorder. Tell somebody you trust it's bothering you. Get into treatment. Follow your plan. Talk about it. Be kind to yourself. You know, you didn't want this. You inherited some of these risks. They weren't your fault. They weren't anybody's fault. It's just who you are. It's okay. Believe you're going to get better and be around people who make you feel better. That helps. You'd like recovery to be just a straight, steady progress. It's not how it looks, okay? It usually is ups and downs, bumps in the road. But overall, you're looking for improvement. So if you have a child who's afraid to go to school, we're really trying to get them back in school, but you know, they still might miss some classes, or they might not make a full day. And that's okay, as long as we're trying to get back into what we want. Support each other. You know, we all have something. We don't all have anxiety, but we all have something that we are challenged with in life. And so let's be kind to each other and be kind to kids and adults who have these disorders. And I will leave you with this, a change of address. In 2017, I will no longer be living on the corner of depression and doubt. Rent is too high, the space is little, there's no room for my dreams to grow. So my new place is located over on Destiny and Belief. If you need me, this is where I'll be. All mail sent to the old address will be returned to the sender. Thank you. Okay, and I just want to point out we have quite a team now called the Family Team at the Depression Center. We're all child-focused, so these are all psychologists and psychiatrists who have specialized in children, and if you want to see any of us, that's the phone number to call. Thank you.